Okay, so we're going to start up our live feed. And as is our custom, we're going to give thanks for the food that we've enjoyed together this evening before we begin the yeshiva study. So I'll just open with that prayer, giving thanks for the food after we've eaten it, which is our custom in Judaism. According to Devarim, Deuteronomy, which says, when you've entered the land and have harvested and had your fill, then give thanks to the Lord. And so this is how we give thanks after the meal. You'll notice that when Yeshua gave thanks for individual food items, it was things like wine, like bread. Well, you've seen tonight, we have a special blessing before wine and a special blessing before bread. But actually, what we don't see a lot of in the New Testament is what was done after the meal. We hear about the meals, but we don't hear that, in fact, even in the first century, they would have been praying after the meal and that Yeshua would have done that very thing. So we see that Yeshua did keep our Jewish traditions just as we are keeping them today. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam, shekol niyeh bidvaro b'shem Yeshua HaMashiach. All blessing comes from you, Lord our God, King of the universe, who's given us all good things to enjoy together in the name of our King Messiah, Yeshua. And hopefully we are going live. I'll get Julia to check that. So we want to welcome everybody who's joining us online. And welcome you to the Beit Melek community. So I encourage you guys, I'll give you a countdown and you guys can all give a big loud Shabbat Shalom to those who are joining us online from various places. So I'll do 3, 2, 1 and then you guys can join me. Okay, so I'm just double checking the live stream there. Make sure we are going on the line and then we will join together. It looks like we're going live there. So 3, 2, 1 Okay, that was pretty good. I think we can do better. So this is for all of those of you who are joining in live online and who are watching the live stream after the fact. 3, 2, 1 Voila, tov meod. Okay, so Shabbat Shalom to all of you who are watching online and welcome to the Beit Melek Yeshiva. We're going to begin with some worship songs and then we're going to go on to our continued study of Yohanan, the Gospel according to John chapter 18. And a lot of us here tonight are really excited about that because of the wonderful things that unfold even in this time of Yeshua's suffering as he's being arrested and put on trial. There is some wonderful, wonderful stuff there in the scriptures. So hopefully our online viewers will be able to hear you guys and your beautiful singing. So we're going to start with one that's pretty familiar to all of us, Atah Adonai. Magen ba'adi kivodi u'me'orim oshiri Atadonai magen ba'adi kivodi u'me'orim oshiri Adonai yeshuati Adonai chaim shele Ani ohe Adonai,
body qui vous dit on est loin proche. Adonai Yeshua te Adonai Chaim Shele Ani Ohe Otcha Adonai Tzamane Bade.
Sung. And we like to do Hinema Tov in this modern way here, well, at least Yaakov does, and he makes everyone else do it this way. Of course, we like the traditional version. Who knows? Maybe the tune that the psalmist came up with was more like this one. Who knows?
Gam yachad mato o manai chevetahe gamia
central prayer of the Jewish faith, and really in conjunction with the prayer of the disciples that Yeshua commanded, Avinu Shabbat Shemayim, our Father who art in the heavens, together with this prayer, Shema Yisrael, are the united central prayers of the Messianic Jewish faith. Adonai Beautiful. You guys are great singers. I hope that Lecholam, everybody online can hear that too. Beautiful. Okay, so we are... quite exciting being the first night that we're going live from our Kehila building. You know, we saw this COVID thing come along and, you know, all the darkness attached to it, all the fear mongering and all the isolation and everything and the way it affects those who suffer from mental illness and all the darkness that came with it. And as believers, we remembered that God is in control of all this. And so then we start saying to ourselves, if I'm not a victim, if I'm more than a conqueror, what does it mean to be more than a conqueror in the darkness? And then good things started to come out of this darkness. We were forced to push our comfort zone to do things differently. And so we now come to this place where we're able to converge some of that darkness, and when we compress it together, we find that it's a created thing. And then when we shine the uncreated light on it, well, that completely changes its form. And so God truly does bring light to that darkness. And that's something that I'm constantly enamored by, is the simple fact that light, that is the light that is present within the person of God, is uncreated, pre-existing, all existing. But darkness is created. And we know, in fact, if we don't know, it's simple logic, that the created thing is subject to the creator. So it's exciting to be now coming to this place where we can still gather together as community according to the word of God. Do not forsake the gathering together of believers, as some are in the habit of doing. Okay, for in doing so, many have wandered from the faith. Together in a room like this is very important. Very important. But we also have the joy of connecting with our online friends. Some of them are in other parts of New Zealand, some of them around the world. And, you know, they're such an encouraging part of our community because they are engaging with us by email, through messaging, and so on. And they're agreeing that looking at the Word of God like this, line upon line, precept upon precept, is what we need to get back to. We need to turn away from the commentaries of scholars and turn to the Word of God. Amen. And this is a wonderful privilege. And I believe that the joy we've had in this is really catching fire in the hearts of a lot of people around the world, in really in a grassroots sort of way, where people are starting to understand that actually it's time to be Bible literate. It's time to be Bible literate. And so it's exciting tonight. We're up to chapter 18 of Habesoal Pe Ochanan, the Gospel according to John. And it's wonderful in our community. I'm going on a bit about this, but I just feel that I should for those who also are watching online. In our community here, there are those of you who have been doing this with Beit Melech for the last 7.5 years. Since we were in our living room, you know, we started with 6 people, then we had 30-odd people crammed into a 10-person living room. We decided that felt a little bit claustrophobic. Well, Yaakov decided that because I don't like small spaces. And so we moved into this lovely building with the Citygate community helping us out. And we have... Let's think about the books of the Bible we have been through in their entirety. We have together studied the entire book of Genesis, Bereshit. We have together studied the entire book of the revelation of Yeshua to Yohanan, the same guy who wrote this book. We have together studied pretty much the entire book of Yeshayah, Isaiah, the prophet. We've studied the entire book of Yonah, Jonah, and numerous others. And we're almost here at the completion of studying the entire Gospel of Yohanan, line upon line. That should feel rewarding, and I think what we've gained from doing that is a much bigger picture of the meta-narrative of God, so that when we look at Yohanan today, well, we all already know that if something is repeated intentionally, it's firmly established. But we know that from the Torah. You know, that didn't just come to us out of thin air. We learnt it, and now we can apply it to this text. One of the many things. So, you know, I do get excited about the Word of God. Tonight we're doing John 18. Those who are watching online need to know that my translation is done from three languages. The oldest language we have for the text is Greek, so I've used the Greek manuscript. We also have a language that is used that is almost as old, the documents we have, which is Aramaic, and then we have the Hebrew translation of the documents, and some believe that maybe some of the original Gospels were written in Hebrew or Hebrew and Aramaic and were translated into Greek. There's no hard evidence of that yet, but there are some textual indicators. So I've made the translation from all three of those languages as a convergent translation to convey the full meaning of what is being said. Now I'm going to do the entire chapter of John 18, and I know that's a lot, but it's okay, and here's why. Because those with a millennial attention span have already stopped watching. So we don't need to worry about not being up to date or savvy as far as being brief. And none of us here have come here to be brief about God's word. So let's just relax. It's going to take a little while, but we are going to get through this. And I would like to, as I said, just do it line upon line. Usually we would read through the whole chapter first, but it is a long chapter, so we are just going to do line upon line here. And I will read you my translation, and you can see on the screen, or if you're watching online on the slide, that the blue text is the New American Standard Bible, to give you a reference of a fairly standard word-for-word English translation. And then underneath in the white is my translation with the Greek, Hebrew, and Aramaic words noted, with a little character above them, G for Greek, H for Hebrew, A for Aramaic, where that's applicable. So, we've just come from chapter 13 through to chapter 17 from a Passover Seder meal where Yeshua washes the feet of his disciples to prepare them as priests for his priesthood, which transcends all priesthoods, and then a conversation with them as they've walked through the city from possibly the west side, or at least the other side of Yerushalayim, to the east side of Jerusalem. And the dialogue as they've walked has come to us in the form of teaching and in an open prayer that Yeshua has prayed to the Father out loud in front of his disciples, kind of like how I shared the gospel through the elements of Shabbat tonight, out loud in front of everybody and on purpose. Okay, and Yeshua did the same thing with his Talmudim in these chapters, and now they're at the edge of Jerusalem on the east side, possibly even having walked via the temple precinct, the outer part of the temple, to get to the east side of Jerusalem. Yeshua spoke these words, that is everything I've just described to you. Yeshua spoke these words, then he went forth with his disciples over the valley of the Kidron. Okay, and Kidron, it means dark. Interesting. It's from the root kadar, which means to mourn. So we could say that Kidron means darkness and mourning. Okay, it's important to understand that. This is the valley they're about to cross, and they'll go down on the east side of Jerusalem, down into the valley, and then over to Gethsemane, the Garden of Gethsemane, okay? So, where there was a garden, and I've just said, Gethsemane, that means press of olives. It's quite funny, you'll see some lexicons will say it's wine press of olives. Maza? I guess they're trying to give you the image in your head of the wine press, because the olive press functioned in a similar way. But what it is this stone that rolls round the barrel of a circular area, and the olives are put into that barrel. As they're crushed, the oil flows out into a channel and so forth. But isn't it interesting that Gethsemane means crushing olives? And what comes out of olives? Oil. And what does the olive oil represent? The Ruach HaKodesh. And who is about to be crushed? Yeshua. And what is he going to do when he resurrects and ascends to the Father? He's going to pour out the Ruach HaKodesh. Do you know there are actually people who believe in coincidences? I know. Staggering. In which he entered with his disciples. Now, Judah, that is Judas Iscariot, okay, also who was betraying him, knew the place, for Yeshua had often met there with his disciples. So this was a place where Yeshua and his disciples hung out a lot, and I've got a couple of images here. First of all, a map from an aerial view, and you can see the temple quite well marked out there in red, and then you'll see across from there the Mount of Olives, and in between there's a little red line going to Gethsemane, and then you'll see that the Kidron Valley goes right up there alongside Jerusalem heading up that way. So it just gives you an idea of the aerial view. And to give you an idea of distance, it's approximately 2 kilometers from the east of Jerusalem to the top of Mount of Olives. And, you know, this is a short walk on a hot day in the middle of summer in Israel. It might take you a little longer, but it's a short walk, very close by. So the trip to Gethsemane wouldn't have been more than about 1 kilometer at most from the east side of the city. And then I've got a topographical, I think that's what you call it. Don't quote me on that. These are the kind of things that I would edit out if this wasn't live. Anyway, it's a side view, let's put it that way, in plain Westy speak. It's a side view of the same thing. So you see the way the valley goes down there from the side of Jerusalem, and you also see that Herod and others before him had built up the platform of the Temple Mount. They'd sort of reclaimed that part in order to build the temple on top of it. And that gives you some idea of that. But then there's an actual picture that I have there of the Kidron Valley. And I took this picture. I took this picture with Julia when we were there last year with my father and my brother. And this is down the lower portion of the Kidron. And if you go up around the corner a little, and then to your right, you'll see Gat Shemanim, Gethsemane. And then if you look to your left, you'll be looking back toward Jerusalem. And then I've got a picture after that that's taken from Gat Shemanim, from the garden, full of these olive trees. So it's aptly named with the olives. And it's looking back to the eastern gate of Jerusalem there. And then I've got a couple more pictures which I'd like to show you of the garden itself with all the olive trees that are there. So I'll just keep it on that last picture and just tell you that what I noticed when I was in the garden, I've been there 3 times now on 3 different occasions. The first time I was there, it's a strange thing to draw your attention, right? Your first time in Yerushalayim, you're in Gat Shemanim, where Yeshua stood, wept, you know, droplets of blood falling from his head. And the thing that comes to Yaakov's mind is, hey, look at those little shoots growing out at the base of that olive tree. And then Yaakov says to Yaakov, really, that's what you're going with? And then the Lord says to Yaakov, think about it. See, what happens is actually you can completely cut down an olive tree. You can cut it level to the ground. You could chip out part of its root system even. But if you leave its root, any of its root in the ground, it will come back up again. And it will keep coming back up again. And it's said, and I think it may well be the absolute immutable truth. It said that the root systems of these olive trees that are in the garden today, the trees themselves are in the hundreds of years old, but the root systems are over 2,000 years old. And I could believe that because I can see the way they regenerate and, if you like, are born again. And, if you like, are resurrected. And so I think it's pretty awesome that I focused on a little shoot coming out of the ground, because it actually all of a sudden became very hyper-real to me. I felt like I was standing between this world and the next. And I felt that I was touching something very tangible, tactile, knowing that, my King Messiah had been in this place, knowing that he had sweated onto this ground. So I just wanted to share that with you guys, a little bit of Yaakov's esoteric take on things. I did want to say a little bit more about the Kidron Valley. Okay, so I explained to you that it means darkness and mourning, and that it may be the physical valley that acted as the figure for that famous phrase from Psalm 23. Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. Well, you know, though we can't say for certain, what we can say is Kidron essentially means dark mourning. So it's pretty close to Valley of the Shadow of Death, if you ask me. Also, if the psalm can be attributed to David, or if it came to someone via David, David did actually walk through this valley with his disciples, if you like. David went down into this valley with his retinue. And we can read about that in 2 Samuel 15:23. And David is in fact a prefigure for the king, the reigning king Messiah. And we know that the Messiah must come from the line of David, King David, HaMelech David. You know what happened with David is, you could say, a very close friend, in fact, so close that he was his son, Avshalom, betrayed him. And as a result of that betrayal, David, HaMelech David, and his retinue had to leave Jerusalem from the east down into the Kidron Valley, up the other side, to go into exile. But David didn't stay in exile. He returned and reigned. Now, isn't that a prefigure of exactly what Yeshua is doing here with his Talmudim? He is about to go into the exile we call death, but he's going to return and reign, just like HaMelech David did. I think that's neat, and I just wanted to focus on that for a second. Let's take a look at verses 3 and 4. Judah. Keep in mind that Judas Iscariot, his name's Judah, Jew, praise. This is hard-hitting stuff for Yeshua. Judah then, having received the 600 to 1,000, and it's more likely to be 1,000, because the word here used, Sbeira, it refers to a cohort, a Roman cohort. Okay, listen to me carefully. A Roman cohort of 1,000 men. And servants from the chief priests. Okay, and these servants were probably members of the temple guard of the Sadducees. But they were in addition to the 1,000-strong Roman cohort. Listen carefully. And the Pelshim. So there were also representatives of the religious group, the Pharisees. Now the Pharisees didn't have their own armed guard. The Sadducees did, as part of the protection for the Sanhedrin, the temple complex, and keeping things in order. The Sadducees had their own temple guard, but the Perushim did not. So the Perushim, the Pharisees, were there as religious representatives. But they were there, both the servants of the high priests and the Pharisees were there in addition to the 1,000 strong cohort of Roman soldiers. But I thought the Jews were to blame for Yeshua's arrest and death and trial. Well, maybe partly, but the Romans were very heavily involved in this. There's a lot to learn here, guys. They came there with torches and oil lamps and weapons. So, this is where it begins. This is where Yaakov begins to expose the true character of a man who for centuries has been taught as kind of an innocent, unwilling bystander in the trial of Yeshua. And that man's name is Pilate. The guy who didn't really want Yeshua to get killed. His wife had a dream and he was a bit superstitious, but he wasn't sure one way or the other. The guy who washed his hands of Yeshua's death and then ordered him to be crucified. However, it seems to have completely escaped many of our Christian scholars that that might be a contradiction. Some even laud him as a righteous Roman Gentile. But only those who have failed to read his history. And why I'm saying this now is, let's ask ourselves the question. Does the governor of Judea, residing in the fortress of Antonia in the Praetorium, have to be alerted, asked permission of, if 1,000 strong cohort is sent to do something? The answer is yes. This cohort was there at the direction of Pilate, or they weren't there at all. So this is where it begins, guys. You need to understand this, because to have some deluded idea that he was just innocently dragged into this is to disregard not only the scripture, but also secular history concerning him. So I wanted to make that clear to you, because I think it's very important we start to dismantle these fables that have entered into Christianity over the last 2,000 years. Start dismantling them and calling the truth as it is. And exposing, if you like, having a stuff NZ doco on the character of Pilate. That was facetious of me, eh? Verse 4. No, did I read verse 4 already? Looks like I'm missing verse 4 from there. Oh, no. So Yeshua, this is cool. So Yeshua, perceiving all the things that were coming upon him, went forth and said to them, "Whom do you seek?" Okay, so just in case you've forgotten, Yohanan, John, his aim is to show us that Yeshua is God with us. If that's not his aim, he probably shouldn't have started, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." So now again he's saying, so Yeshua knew everything that was about to happen, guys. Keep that in mind as you read on. That's what Yohanan is saying. Keep that in mind as you read on. Yeshua seeks them out and says, "Whom do you seek?" What happens next is flipping awesome. And that's me being calm about it. They answered him, Yeshua HaNatzri. We seek Yeshua, the consecrated, devoted one. We seek Yeshua, the branch. Netzir is the root of Netzirit. They don't know it, but they are fully filling prophecy. Yeshayahu, Isaiah the prophet, speaks of the Netzir, the branch that will come. And he's speaking of the Messiah. So they don't know it, but they're actually asking, we seek Yeshua the Messiah. In their minds, they seek Yeshua from that dirty town of Nazareth that nothing good comes out of. And if you've been there recently, it is pretty grubby, so I can see why they might have thought that. Okay, we seek Yeshua of Nazareth. And he said to them, I am. I exist. And Yehuda, also who was betraying him, was standing with them. So when he said to them, I am, I exist, they drew back and fell to the ground. Yehuda with them. That's why Yohanan makes a point of saying Yehuda was standing with them. He was one of the ones that drew back and fell to the ground. What happened? Yeshua stated his deity, knowing everything that would happen. He manifested power as the present I am, and that power emanated from him to such a degree that it pushed who knows how many, maybe all of them, backward and to the ground. Some of them, particularly the religious among them, would now be beginning to understand who they were coming to arrest. And if they didn't believe the Messiah, they at least believed the powerful man of God. Yohanan shows us that God with us had the power to prevent them from arresting him. This is what Yohanan is showing us. It's easy for a vulnerable, weak man to be humble and acquiesce because he has no strength. He has no power. He essentially has no choice. But for a man full of strength who knows he can defeat his opponent, to humble himself and acquiesce, that's something. So Yohanan makes it clear that he could have avoided arrest entirely. They drew back and fell to the ground. Therefore, he again asked them, whom do you seek? And they said, Yeshua HaNatzri. Yeshua answered, I told you that, and this time he kept the power back, didn't he? I told you that I am. I exist. And that, folks, is called mercy. I want to tell you something about this strike them to the ground idea. Because it's pretty interesting when we look at rabbinic Judaism. The Hebrew tradition concerning the phrase fall to the ground or strike to the ground can refer to striking a person dead immediately. Okay, so this idea of power coming out from God and striking people to the ground is associated in Jewish tradition with being struck to your death. God performs this in Jewish tradition via his angels, and in particular Gabriel. The Bavli, or the Talmud, Babylonian Talmud says this: let the master of thoughts come. The master of thoughts is God. And take vengeance on you. Immediately Gavriel came and struck them to the ground, and they died immediately. This is in the consciousness of the first century religious Jew. Shmot Rabbah, another part of the Talmud, says, if you transgress your father's command, immediately comes Gabriel and strikes you to the ground. So, if this tradition that finds its way to the Talmud is from the first century, which is very likely that it did make its way verbally from the first century, then some of those present, the religious Jews present, were aware of this idea of striking to the ground by God being a death sentence. So they were getting up off of the ground, wrestling with all these ideas of, okay, so why am I not dead? He clearly has the power to do what I know God's capable of doing, but he hasn't decided to do that. Can you imagine the conflict in the religious that were there? There was conflict. Maybe not so much for the Romans, but I can tell you this, the Romans and their gods and their superstitions made them likely candidates for having a little freak out when some guy just says, I am, and everyone falls over. Okay, so everyone was a bit confused. Yeshua answered the second time, I told you that I am, I exist. So if you seek me, let these go their way, speaking of his Talmudim. And he said this to make full the word which he had spoken, of those whom you have given me, I lost not one. And earlier in John, we see that that was spoken with the exception of Yehuda, Judas Iscariot. So, as a righteous shepherd, his thought, when he's about to get arrested, put in chains, put on trial, knowing he's going to be put to death, his first thought is for who? The sheep. Okay, arrest me, leave these guys alone. That's the shepherd you and I serve. Voila. Feel safe. His first thought is to make sure that you're protected. Shimon Kephar, that's Simon Peter. Shimon Kephar then, having a short sword, drew it and struck the high priest, the high priest's servant, and cut off his right ear. And the servant's name was Malchus, or Malchut. It means kingdom. Interesting. So all these guys, to be clear, we're talking about approximately 1,200 people have come to arrest Yeshua. So even if we bring his disciples into this, 1,200 people to arrest 12. And Pilate is involved in sending the cohort, part of that, the 1,000. So Pilate wants to see Yeshua arrested. Don't believe the hype. Pilate's got all the news channels playing his story, but in reality, behind the scenes, he wants to see Yeshua arrested. 1,200 people. It's interesting that John's gospel is the only one to name both the perpetrator and the victim in this. John is the only one to name Peter as the person who cuts off the ear, and he's also the only one to name the servant. What does that tell us? It tells us two things. He knew the servant of the high priest, and he knew his name. It also tells us, I think, and this is my opinion, is this where we do the thing, Yaakov's opinions are not the opinions of the Beth Malik Trust. Here's what I believe. I believe, and I think the text of John and the other Gospels backs me up. John, Peter, and James, so Yohanan, Kepha, Ve'Yakov, they were very close friends. Yohanan loved Kepha. In fact, he looked up to him in many ways because of his chutzpah, because of his tenacity. And Kepha loved Yohanan as well. So much so that later in the gospel, when we find out that Kepha is going to do these great things and that Yeshua prophesies over him, yes, a tragic end, but also a great role in the burgeoning body of believers, Kepha, contrary to popular belief, says, what about John? Not because he wants John to suffer, but because he wants John to get a big job too. He doesn't want his friend to get left out. That's the fact. It's not because he's mad that John wasn't selected for this role. It's that he didn't want John to get left out. Well, John had that same kind of love for Peter. And you know what? John is here observing all this. He was there in Gethsemane. And while he stood and did nothing, Peter brought out a sword and said, I'm going to protect Yeshua. And because of what Yeshua says next, people judge Kepha poorly. But you know how John judges him? A hero. This is the guy out of all 11 of us who had been told by Yeshua, now take a sword. Okay? Read the Gospels. Know your Bible. This is the guy who had the courage to do something to defend Yeshua. Was it what Yeshua wanted to happen? Maybe not. But I think Yohanan is saying, let's name Peter this hero Peter. Because I'm also going to have to tell you about his denials of Yeshua. But I want you to know Peter's a hero. That yes, he's also got some weaknesses. But I want you to know he's my friend and he's a hero. And I think that's why Yohanan names him. And like I said, he named Malchus, Malchut, kingdom, the servant of the high priest, because he knew him. And how do we know that? Verses 15 and 16 tell us that he was known to the high priest. Yohanan was known personally to the high priest and therefore knew his retinue as well. Think about that. Yohanan carried on relationship with the Sadducees, the Sanhedrin, the high priest, even while he was still a disciple of Yeshua, which means there were also others within that community that were in favor of Yeshua but didn't speak up. So this whole idea that all of the Jewish religious leaders were against Yeshua is nonsense. In fact, it's a deceptive lie. And the enemy has used it well throughout Christian history. Let's read on. So Yeshua said to Kepha, put the short sword into the sheath. Should I not drink the cup which the Father has given me? Kind of a rebuke, but I don't think it was a harsh one. I think it was, I understand why you did that. But Peter, there's a bigger picture. And the cup that the Father has given me, what is that cup? Well, for one, it's the cup that nobody wants to drink at Passover. The cup of plagues, figuratively speaking. But in fact, the cup that the Father has given Yeshua to drink is the cup of his wrath. The cup of his wrath against sin. Yaakov, what you're saying, that God is wrathful? Yes. Against sin, against the evil one. And because human beings have sinned, He needs to make a way for his wrath to be outworked so that we can be delivered from that wrath. And his son chose to drink the cup of that wrath for us. The scripture says he became sin for us. Yes, the loving God is also a wrathful God, and his wrath must be satisfied. This is not a pagan teaching. It is a teaching of the Torah, an ancient Hebrew teaching. And I'm going to keep going on about this on and on and on. The so-called reframing of Paul's words, the so-called new view of Paul, is a satanic poison to the church because it ignores the wealth of scripture to the contrary. So Yeshua says, I've got to drink this cup, Simon, put your sword away. Malchus is like, come on, somebody get this guy. I mean, come on. Is that my right? Okay, yeah. Come on, glue this back on, guys. Yalla. I don't know what Malchus was thinking, but he was probably having a good cry. I would have been. So the 1,000-strong cohort and the commander and the servants of the Jewish religious leaders arrested Yeshua and bound him and led him to, and I'll say, so it's Annas, and I know that that's tricky, you know, Annas, you don't want to mispronounce that. But Hananiah in Ivrit, Annas, he was led to him first, for he was the father-in-law to Caiaphas, who was the high priest that year. And there's a lot going on in here. We've just seen that Yeshua had the power to wipe these guys out. He stated who he was as God with us, and they all fell backwards to the ground. So, I mean, he didn't have to get arrested. So he allowed them to bind him. Does that sound familiar? At 33 years of age, Yitzhak allowed Abraham to bind him. Voila. And then we've got this line here, Annas, look how careful I'm being, the father-in-law of Caiaphas, who was high priest that year. If you know the Torah, you are going, what the? He was high priest for that year? What kind of high priest is this? It's no high priest according to the Torah. First of all, he wasn't of the line of Aharon, disqualified. He was put into this position by the Romans. Disqualified, man. Second of all, a high priest was high priest until the day he died. What's with the for this year business? That tells me something without knowing all the history, which if we read into it, we know that the Romans put these guys in place for their own means. But even if we didn't know that history, if we knew the Torah and the requirements for high priest and we read that one line, we know straight away this is apostate. Isn't it neat that if you know all of the Bible, you have enough information to both understand other parts of the Bible and make clear moral decisions in every area of your life without ever reading a commentary or knowing history? That's the reality. Verse 14. Now, Caiaphas, or Caiaphah, and actually his historical name is Yosef ben Caiaphah. That was his full name. Was the one who had advised the Jewish religious leaders, the Judeans, that it was expedient for one man to die on behalf of all the people, Kol Ha'am, all the people of Israel, all the Jews. And he said that in, it's quoted in John 11, 49-52. Shimon Kefar was following Yeshua, and so was another disciple. And as is Yohanan's custom, he doesn't name himself. Yohanan is the other disciple, just like Yohanan is the unnamed disciple throughout his book. Because the author's not naming himself, he's writing about others, isn't he? It makes perfect sense. Now the disciple was known to the high priest and entered with Yeshua into the courtyard of the high priest. So it's kind of like when you're going, well, most of you guys are, I don't know your history, but you probably don't frequent nightclubs or anything like that. It's like when I was a teenager and I went with some cool dude to some exotic club, and he walked straight in and they stopped me. Okay, I'm Peter. My cool mate was John. He knew the guy who owned the club and the bouncer. And the bouncer didn't like little hobbit boy who came and tried to get him behind him. This is a bit what this was like, but in a more religious setting. Now the next slide is a picture of a well-to-do home in Jerusalem in the first century CE, and it is likely to be similar to the house of Annas. Oh, it's so tricky. And I've got a picture there showing you where the courtyard is that they've just talked about. Okay, so he was brought into the courtyard, and Peter was left outside like Fred Flintstone. None of the millennials will get that one. So that just, I just want you to have a visual for what that was like. And I've got an arrow there pointing to the sort of reception room where they probably did the pre-trial of Yeshua. Very unusual, by the way. It was not according, not only not according to Torah law, but it wasn't done according to first century Mishnaic law either. So they weren't doing the right thing. This was all being done wrong, illegally, both by Roman standards and by Jewish standards, according to the Torah, the Tanakh. But it just gives you an idea of where they would have taken Yeshua to do the sort of trial part. And that courtyard is probably where they built the coal fire to warm themselves by as well. It's inside the complex of the house, but it's quite large and outdoorsy, so it's a place where they could have had the coal fire that we read about. Verse 16 to 17, but Kefar was standing at the door outside. Okay, let's go back to the picture. So one of those doors on the outside, Kefar was hanging out there, because like I said, he didn't get past the bouncer. But Yohanan had gone into the courtyard. So the other disciple left them outside because he didn't like Peter, because he went around swinging swords, chopping people's ears off, jumping out of boats when he wasn't supposed to. No. Yohanan was like, Efo kefa, Efo, ahe. Where's my mate? He's getting in here too. So he goes out and he brings Kefar in. He went out and spoke to the doorkeeper and brought Kefar in. Then the young girl who kept the door, so the doorkeeper was a woman. They had woman bouncers back in the first century. I don't know. They must have. Yeah. Said to Kefar, you are not also one of this man's disciples, are you? Think about it. He's about to go into a place where almost everybody there is out to get Yeshua, wants him put to death, doesn't like him or his teaching or his disciples, and here's this girl challenging him. You know what I would have done if I was Kefar? Hell no. Hell no, I'm not his disciple. You must be confused. And then I would have quickly slipped in the door. Because that's how I roll. I'm a bit of a coward that way. But Peter isn't really a coward. He had just, think about it. We get real hard on him, don't we? But think about it. Less than 30 minutes beforehand, he had faced down 1,200 people with a short sword on his own. That's not cowardice. Okay, so for whatever reason, he denied Yeshua and he was allowed in at Yohanan's request. Now the servants and the attendants were standing, having made a fire of coals, for it was cold and they were warming themselves. And Kephar was also with them, standing and warming himself. So this is in that courtyard that you saw inside. He had come inside. The high priest then questioned Yeshua. Actually, not the current high priest, but the father-in-law of the high priest, Annas. Hananiah. He's the one who's about to question Yeshua. Then he questioned Yeshua about his disciples. Can you imagine? So Yohanan's in the room. Kephar's just outside in the courtyard, and they hear, tell us about your disciples. I mean, their butt cheeks are clenching, I'm telling you. They're worried. He asks about his disciples and about his teaching, his doctrine, his instruction. Yeshua answered him, I have spoken openly, unreservedly, without ambiguity to the world, to this world. I always taught in the gathering places, in the synagogue, and in the house of the temple, where all the Jews come together. And I spoke nothing in secret. Why do you question me? In other words, you already know the answers to the questions you're asking me. You've literally heard me say what my position is on the doctrines of our faith. And you have servants who have heard me say them and have reported them to you. You're not being genuine or honest. You have provided no corroborating witnesses. You have made no official charge through the right channels. You are conducting an illegal proceeding according to Torah and according to Roman law. So Yeshua is simply challenging what's going on, and he does it very politely, I might add, doesn't he? And notice that he said, I said nothing in secret. And there's a very important principle here about the gospel. The gospel is not a secret. The gospel is not full of secret knowledge that only initiates can access. The gospel is spoken publicly, clearly, without ambiguity, and is available to all. So that when we hear about secret revelations of God, when we hear about individuals who have discovered secret things but have no evidence of them, we are not hearing about the gospel, no matter what kind of name they give themselves, apostle such and such, prophet such and such. Because the gospel is not a secret, and anyone who brings a secret gospel brings a false gospel. It's a very important thing to understand, and it's right here at the inception, at the birth of messianic faith, from the mouth of Yeshua himself. When he had said this, one of the attendants standing nearby struck Yeshua. Just so you know, that is entirely illegal, certainly according to Torah. And it's also illegal according to the Mishnah. This you might not have known. First century rabbinical teaching or oral law disallowed this type of behavior. In fact, there was a fine for it. So this guy strikes him, and Yeshua said, is that the way, he said to Yeshua, is that the way you answer the high priest? Yeshua answered him, if I have spoken wrongly, testify to the wrong, but if rightly, why do you strike me? Yeshua was being so gracious, he effectively said, if you disagree with what I've said, qualify your disagreement, use your words, you know, like we used to do when our kids were toddlers. Okay, use your words, stop smacking each other in the face. But Yeshua's essentially saying, follow protocol. You know the teachings of the rabbis in our time that you should be debating with me, not striking me. And here's the interesting thing. I just looked through my notes here because I wanted to share it with you. I think it's interesting. So there was this fine for striking someone in this setting based on Mishnah law. Okay? And it was for a monetary type called zuzim. And the fine for striking someone like this in a trial setting of this kind was upwards of 200 zuzim. For a person of stature, the price was higher, closer to 400 zuzim. So, for example, if you had struck a rabbi or a teacher or a community leader, the punishment was higher. Your fine was more like 400 zuzim. The Mishnah fine for cutting off someone's ear, 400 zuzim. So it's interesting that in one way, certainly as a figure, Yeshua essentially pays Peter's fine by receiving a strike that he should have been paid 400 zuzim for. He cancels out the fine that Peter's obligated to pay. Isn't that interesting? You know, it's not like you need to, next time you're sharing the gospel, you don't need to go, hey, do you know about the zuzim? So, this is it, da, 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 da. I mean, it's not that important, but I think it's interesting, at least. What do you think, Aliyah? Interesting? Yeah. When he had said this, one of the attendants standing nearby, oh, I've already read that. I'm just going into repeat mode. Verse 24. So, Hananiah, or if you like, Anas, I don't think most people watching this are going to get the whole West Auckland thing about that. It is kind of funny though, eh? Unfortunate name. So what are you going to name your boy? Okay, so Hananiah sent him, that's Yeshua, bound to Caiaphas, the high priest. Now Shimon Kephar was standing and warming himself. So they said to him, you are not also of his disciples, are you? He denied it and said, I am not. Keep in mind, again, he has just overheard Yeshua being questioned about his disciples, and he's standing in the next room. Yochanan is still there. It's life and death for him at this point. Some of you may be heroes of the faith, and probably would have said, I am. It is I, disciple. Strike me if you dare. Well, all I can say is, Baruch Hashem, your faith is great. I would have done the same thing as Peter did. Nope, not me. Give us another Heineken. Yeah, okay. So there we go. Let's not be too harsh on Kephar. One of the servants of the high priest, being a relative of the one whose ear Kephar cut off. Oh, come on. If I'm Kephar, I'm like, really? Come on. I mean, he was really getting laid into, the poor guy. One of these servants, who was a relative of Malchut, kingdom, the servant, said, did I not see you in the garden with him? Kephar then denied it again, and immediately a rooster crowed. And we know from the other gospel that Kephar was shattered. He was absolutely shattered, gutted by what he had done. But seriously, I mean, this guy really got dealt to. There was an eyewitness to him cutting off the ear there, asking him, "Aren't you that guy?" What I find interesting is that in the other Gospels, we're told about Kephar's grief and gutted response to this and how he goes off. But Yohanan doesn't dwell on it. He's kind of like, okay, Kephar was in a tough situation, and yes, he did what Yeshua said he would do. Let's move on. That's how when I read this, that's the feeling I get in my spirit. Feelings don't define truth, Yaakov. You said so. I know, but just so you know, it's my opinion. As I said, the Beth Melek Trust is not responsible. Verse 25. Then they led Yeshua from Caiaphas into the praetorium. Okay, so notice that unlike the other Gospels, Yohanan doesn't tell us about the trial before Caiaphas. And you know, Yohanan is telling a meta-narrative that's just a little bit different from the so-called synoptic Gospels. He is interested in the key elements of how this tells us that Yeshua, God with us, is going through the process of fully filling the Torah, the Ketuvim, the Nevim, the other way around. So then they led him from Caiaphas into the praetorium, that is the governor's courtroom. And it was early, daybreak, and they themselves did not enter into the praetorium so that they would not be defiled, become ritually unclean, but might eat the Pascha, that is, the Passover sacrifice made for the day of Passover, not the Passover Seder on the night of the 14th. During the first century, the temple Passover sacrifices were made and were allowed to be eaten right through until the 15th of Nisan. So for those people who foolishly say, therefore Yeshua didn't celebrate a Seder with his disciples, because they're talking about the Passover, they are saying this because they're ignorant of first century temple practice, which was that the Passover Seder was held in the family home, and then there was another sacrifice made, or actually sacrifices made, that were called Chagigah, meaning the holiday sacrifices. And you know, this even dates back to the scriptures themselves. So I did want to just mention that to you. And you can read my notes to find the scriptures where those Passover sacrifices were made. And that's what's being referred to here, not the Passover Seder, which is also legitimate, but has already happened. And so this is early in the morning now, continuing the day of the 14th of Nisan. Okay, so they don't want to go into the house because it will defile them. Tell me where that is in the Torah. Where does it say in the Torah that going into a Gentile's house will defile you? Stop looking, you won't find it, because it doesn't say so. What they're practicing is a first century Jewish tradition and not a command of the Torah. And yeah, it's in some ways it's quite shocking, really. So I'll read to you from the Mishnah. And these laws have come to us orally from the first century and were codified in the second century. In the dwelling houses of the Gentiles or idolaters, the dwelling houses of the Gentiles or idolaters are unclean. This is what the Mishnah teaches, not what the Torah teaches. Okay? If the collectors for the government, that is the Romans, enter into a house to dwell in it, all in the house are defiled. That's pretty hardcore, eh? And actually that statement qualifies the current text. The Roman governor is in this huge Roman house. And so they're refusing to go into this house because they don't want to be defiled by being around Gentiles. Not because there's any food there that's not kosher, but because of rabbinic law, first century rabbinic law. Not because of the Torah. And it's important we understand that, because as we read on in the New Testament and we get to the book of Acts, we see that Shimon Kephar, Simon Peter, has this vision of animals coming down in a cloth, all sorts of animals, including unclean ones. Kill and eat. He said, but Lord, I've never eaten anything unkosher in my life. Later he finds out that what the Lord was saying was, you can hang out in Gentiles' houses. It's okay. I didn't say you couldn't. Those were the teachings of men. They were not my law. So it's good that we know this and we understand that that's what was happening here. So they stayed outside of the house. Therefore Pilate went out to them and said, what accusation do you bring against this man? What accusation do you bring against this man? Does that sound disingenuous to you? If it doesn't, it should. So not so long ago, I agreed to send 1,000 soldiers to arrest Yeshua. I must have known why they were going to arrest him. Either that, or I'm the most useless governor that's ever walked the face of the earth and have absolutely no knowledge of anything or control over my own people. No, the reality is he knew what they wanted to accuse him of. So his question is disingenuous. What accusation do you bring against this man? In other words, let's make a show of this, because I know I've got people in the high priesthood who I make political deals with, and they know I know, and we've all conspired together to arrest this guy, so let's put on a good performance. Have you seen that happen in the media? I have, many times. And it's happening here. I wanted to show you a picture of whereabouts the Antonia Fortress is and where the Praetorium is, in to give you perspective, so you see where the temple is and then where the fortress is, quite close to the temple, and inside the fortress, the Praetorium. They answered and said to him, okay, so the religious leaders said to Pilate, if this man were not an evildoer, we would not have delivered him to you. And that's just outright nonsense. They had no evidence of any evildoing. They had no corroborating witnesses. In the other trials, the witnesses they did have conflicted with one another, thus making them illegitimate witnesses according to Torah. Everything that happened with regard to this trial of Yeshua was illegal, both by Roman law and the law of Scripture. So Pilate said to them, take him yourselves and judge him according to your law. And I've got to say, I think that's hilarious, because Josephus says of Pilate, that what he did so as to put an end to Jewish law. So Josephus the historian says that what Pilate did, he did to put an end, or to try and put an end to Jewish law. And what is he saying here? He said, take him yourselves and judge him according to your Torah. Oh, you mean the Torah you're wanting to put an end to? So you see the character of the man. It's important. This is a guy who the scripture, the New Testament, Luke's gospel tells us, mixed the blood of Jews, Galilean Jews, with their sacrifices. Do you think he liked Jews? Do you think he liked the idea of a Jewish king Messiah? He didn't. He would aggravate Jews in order to get them to fight back, and then he would decimate them. 4 years after Yeshua's crucifixion, Pilate did the same thing, tried to decimate the Samaritans on Mount Gerizim. The Samaritans complained to the emperor, and Pilate was recalled. Pilate had a history of trying to provoke and then decimate his enemies or the subjects of his governorship. This is not a nice man. This is not a man who sort of fell into this situation and wasn't really responsible. This is a wicked man who intentionally did these things. So he says, you know that law that I'm trying to stop, why don't you try him by that law? The Jewish religious leaders said to him, we are not permitted to put anyone to death. And that was pretty much true. There were some exceptions, but generally speaking, under Roman occupation, the Jewish leaders weren't allowed to put people to death without approval from the Romans. There are exceptions, but generally speaking, that's true. This was said to make full the word of Yeshua, which he spoke, signifying by what kind of death he was about to die. And we find that in John 3, 14 to 15, and John 12, 32, where Yeshua talks about being lifted up, like the serpent that Moses lifted up. In other words, he would not die based on the punishment for blasphemy in the Torah, which was stoning, but he would die on a Roman cross, and he had prophesied that. Therefore, Pilate entered again into the praetorium and summoned Yeshua and said to him, are you the king of the Jews? Why is he asking him that? He already knows that the Jewish religious leaders dislike the idea that Yeshua is the king of the Jews. He already knows that Yeshua is being called by some the king of the Jews. So why does he ask Yeshua that? He's trying to find a legitimate case to put Yeshua to death. And a legitimate case would involve insurrection in the form of him being a king who opposes the emperor. Because only the emperor was the manifest God king of Rome. No one else could be. So Pilate was actually looking for a reason to kill Yeshua so that he would be above board with Roman law. He wouldn't get it in the ear. Okay? And I wanted to show you a picture of the Praetorium. And in the back there, you know, this is an artist's rendering of what the pavement or Gabbatha was, where it was. It was kind of like a riser where judgment would be passed on criminals. And you see outside the Praetorium is where all the Jewish religious leaders are. And look, at this point, there's probably, I mean, the Sanhedrin is 70 strong. Some of them were for Yeshua, some of them against. There might have been, I don't know, a couple of hundred others, not more. And then possibly the cohort of Roman soldiers and a few of the temple police. So there weren't more than probably 1,100 to 1,200 people there. There were hundreds of thousands of people in Israel at that time. So we're dealing with a tiny percentage of Jews who were opposed to Yeshua. But they were Jewish religious leaders who had political power. And just like today in our country, where a minority government can lord power over a public that for the most part disagrees 80% with their legislation, nonetheless they get away with it, don't they? And that's what was happening here. Yeshua answered, "Are you saying this from your own soul, or did others tell you about me?" Yeshua knows this guy. Yeshua's thinking, "I know you, Pilate. I know all about the conversations you've had with the religious leaders. I know you know what's been said about me. So I'm giving you an opportunity here. Does this come from your own soul, or did others tell you? I know the answer, but here's your opportunity." Pilate didn't take the opportunity. He answered, "I'm not a Jew, am I? Your own people and the chief priests delivered you to me. What have you done?" Not the whole truth, eh? "Your own people and 1,000 of my soldiers delivered you to me." Not the whole truth, but "your own people and the chief priests delivered you to me." And in fact, "your own people's" not the truth either, because actually Yeshua's own people, by the hundreds of thousands, either believed he was Elijah, or the prophet Moses promised, or one of the other prophets, or probably the King Messiah. So no, his own people didn't deliver him to Pilate. A small number of power brokers, using their power to keep their power, delivered him. I was at a Christian conference once in Canada, and a girl sat down beside me and said, "I heard you're Jewish." I said, "Yes, I am." She said, "But you guys killed Jesus." I wish I could tell you that's the only time that's happened. I said to her, "Yes, we did. And unless you can admit that you killed Jesus, you cannot be saved." And that was gracious, Yaakov, because usually I would have bitten someone's head off for that. But the reality is this: we all killed Yeshua. The price of our sin killed Yeshua. But let's get real on the politics. Rome had as much to do with his crucifixion, if not more, than the Jews of the first century did. And if we're going to pick on the Jews of the first century, we can only pick on a few illegitimate Jewish leaders, because we've already agreed that this priesthood is apostate. It's not even a valid priesthood. Actually, the more valid priesthood was through Zechariah and his son, Yohanan the Immerser, who passed on the priesthood in baptizing or immersing Yeshua. And now Yeshua rises from his immersion to complete all things, the transcendent priest over all priesthoods in the line of Melchizedek. Yeshua answered, "My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, then my servants would be fighting so that I would not be handed over to the Jewish religious leaders. But as it is, my kingdom is not from this place, not of this side." Was he saying he wasn't king of this world? No. He said, "My kingdom is not of this world." Do you understand the difference? He is king over this world, but the this world he's talking about is the sin-affected world. So is he of sin? No. He's of the heavens. Therefore, his kingdom is not of this world, but his kingdom will renew and reign over this world. So a lot of people go around saying, "Oh, Satan's the king of this world. He's the spirit of the air. He's got the power. Satan's got the power." We need to use the phrase protect me by the blood of Jesus in order to make sure Satan's power doesn't hurt me. No. Yeshua is king, whether you believe it or not, whether you follow him or not. Like I said before, you don't get to vote. Satan is allowed for a time to continue to fight against what has already been established, that he is defeated. And we can either walk in our life as Messiah followers, as conquerors who know he's been defeated, or as superstitious, terrified children who think that he still has power over us. We've got a choice to make. We either follow the King Messiah who has victory over Satan and the darkness, or we cower, believing that somehow he doesn't have full victory, that somehow we should be afraid. We are more than conquerors. Therefore, Pilate said to him, "So you are a king." You see what's happening here? Are you the king of Jews? I need you to say it. Say it. It's all, you know, if it were today, it would be, he'd have his cell phone out. Record. I need you to say it. So are you the king of the Jews? So you are a king. And Pilate's thinking, good, insurrection, crucify him. I'm going to get away with this. And I'm going to make it look like it's the Jews' fault. Seriously, that's what he's thinking. Yeshua answered, "You say that I am a king." Look what Yeshua does. "You just said that I'm a king, Pilate." And he looks him straight in the eye. "You say that I am a king. For this I have been born, and for this I have come into this world, to testify, bear witness to the immutable truth. Everyone who is of the immutable truth hears in my voice." In other words, Pilate, you don't know who I am. You don't know why I've come. You can't hear it because you're not of the truth. And then what does Pilate say? "You're right. I repent. Forgive me." Pilate says, "Well, I've just been reading Nietzsche. And, you know, what doesn't kill you makes you stronger." That's BS, by the way. It's not true that what doesn't kill you makes you stronger. What doesn't kill you has the potential for you to respond to it in two different ways. Either to choose to overcome or to choose to be a victim. So it doesn't make you stronger unless you act to be stronger. So Nietzsche was as fucked as any of the philosophers who speak relativity and superhuman nonsense. But Pilate was just a precursor to that, who had been listening to other Greek philosophers talk the same nonsense more than 2,000 years ago. So, you know, nothing new under the sun. Pilate says to him, "What is truth? What is truth?" I mean, this is nonsense. What is truth? It's fakakda. He had an opportunity and he failed. And when he had said this, he went out again to the Jewish religious leaders, who he knew personally and was paying off. In fact, he had put Caiaphas into his position. Do you know that? Pilate had made sure that Caiaphas would be in that position. He said to them, this is what Pilate said to them, because he's thinking, I'm off the hook here. I can crucify this guy and Rome won't have a problem with it because he said he was a king. And I'm going to make sure they know that that is why I crucified him. I'm going to put a sign on his cross that says, Yeshua, the King of the Jews, because I want an out with Rome. Some people think Pilate put that there as a hero who was saying, see, I do what I want. He is the King of the Jews, but you bad guys killed him. No. Pilate put that sign there as evidence that he had a good reason to crucify Yeshua. That's why he did it. And he said to them, I find no reason to punish him. That's bollocks. But you have a custom that I release someone for you at the Pesach, at the Passover. Do you wish then that I release for you? And this is what he would have said if he was an innocent bystander in all this. Do you want me then to release for you this man? That's what he would have said if Pilate was just this fabled innocent bystander who wasn't really responsible. But what he did was he taunted them. He knew what they hated. They hated the idea that Yeshua was the King Messiah. And so what does he say to them? Do you want me to release the King of the Jews? And what about if we do that like this? If the Greek is often translated Jewish religious leaders or Judeans, he was being even more specific. Do you want me to release the King of the Jewish religious leaders? So they cried out again, and I mean, we know what they're going to cry out. He's just baited them, and he did it intentionally. Not this man, but Bar-Abbas, or Bar-Abba. Now, Bar-Abbas was a robber. And some people will say he was an insurrectionist. But actually, the Greek word means thief, means robber. People like to do the revisionist history stuff and say, oh, he was a zealot leader, you know. But no, he was just a plain old thief and a robber. And they crucified robbers in those days. If we still did that today, we'd probably have less robbers, I'm guessing. But, look at what his name is. Look at the man who Yeshua literally died as a substitute for. Quite literally. He died as a substitute for you and I, but he literally died as a substitute for this robber, this common thief, named Bar-Abbas. This is Aramaic. In Hebrew, we might say Bar-Abba or Ben-Abba. But Bar in Aramaic is kind of a convergent term that mixes the idea of son with the idea of brit, covenant. Right? Ben, brit, bar. So it really means son, covenant son, would be a good way to describe the Aramaic word bar. Covenant son of Abba. You couldn't make this stuff up. This is history. The covenant son of the father dies in place of a man named the covenant son of the father. And we saw earlier on that Yeshua knew everything that was about to happen to him, including this. And there's lots of conjecture about how Bar-Abbas might have responded to that whole event we don't know, do we? But maybe it's possible that he came to understand the true meaning of his name and the true work of Yeshua. I certainly hope that's true. And although we don't know the outcome for Pilate, for his sake, I hope he eventually repented, given his character and insistence on doing the wrong thing toward the Jewish people throughout his governorship. I find it more likely that he walked the path of Pharaoh and ended up on the bad side of the equation. Unlike many Christian preachers, I am no fan of Pilate. And yes, I did set out to expose him tonight. I'm not ashamed of that fact. But I think that I used the text to do that. And I think that history qualifies what I've said tonight. If you would like to know more about Pilate, there are some famous writers, Philo of Alexandria and Josephus, who write about Pilate and give him a less than glowing report. So you could follow that up. I'm going to post the notes to all this on our website in my commentary section, and at the bottom is an appendix of the information from Philo and Josephus about Pilate, so you know that I'm just not making stuff up or pulling it out of my shorts, as it were. So I just want to give you guys a chance. We've been live now for almost 2 hours. You can almost hear the people going to sleep online. And if anyone is still awake, they might want to ask some questions. So I'll invite Rav Ruben to come up and turn this mic on, and then if you guys have some questions, you're welcome to answer them. We won't drag it out too long, but I do want to give you an opportunity, and I want our viewers from overseas to understand that this is a dialogue in this community, so you are welcome to ask questions if you would like to. Mark down the back there looks like a Hasidic rabbi. Without my glasses on, he looks like he's from the Haredi community. Shalom Aleichem Achi. Baruch Hashem. Baruch Hashem. Okay. Kenzie's got a question.
You know the part where Jesus is like, after Pilate says, "Are you a king?" Then, and then he's like, "You say that I'm king," blah, 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 blah. And then it's like, "Everyone who is of the truth hears in my voice," that you translated on that.
Yeah.
Is that like, you know how we do the shofar thing?
The shofar, yeah.
Yeah, is that like the same voice word?
In Hebrew, called, yes.
Is it like the same, you know?
Yeah, same word, called, yeah, for
and
voice.
When it's like in my word, is it saying like the Holy Spirit in a way?
Yes, in a way. In most English translations, it will say, "Everyone who is of the truth hears my voice." Okay? And I've just said, the Greek actually says, not the Greek, but the Hebrew actually says, "hears in my voice."
Yeah, mine says, is the my voice one. That's what
yeah.
I'm saying. Is it saying, like, "hears in my voice," as in we, like, get the sermon from the Holy Spirit and stuff? And that's
yes.
How you start to get
the only way you can hear Yeshua is in him. Is really what Yeshua is saying. So yes, you're right. So when Yeshua is crucified, he's crushed like the olives in the garden of Gethsemane. When he's resurrected, he carries the oil of the crushing. And when he's by the Father's side, he pours out that oil, Father and Son, upon his Talmudim, his disciples, and upon you and I subsequently. And therefore, with him in us, we are able to recognize his voice. So that's essentially what he's saying to Pilate, who doesn't recognize any of those things. Good question. Yes, Paula. No, we need to use the mic because I like for people online to be able to hear you too, if that's okay.
Going back to that cohort of the 1,000
yes,
soldiers,
yeah.
In the brackets you had the word like spiral or something?
Yeah, that's the Greek word.
So do they like gather like a spiral?
I think that's the idea, is that they gather in a circle, a wide circle in their regiment. I think that's where the idea comes from.
Oh,
yeah. I'm not certain, but I think that is why they use that word for the cohort. Yeah, it's a good question. Impressive is as long as they're not coming for you, I guess. Yeah.
All right.
Yes.
One right here. Going back to the Tanakh.
Yes. Which part of the Tanakh?
Where Moses was commissioned by God to go to his people in Egypt?
Yes.
So when Moses asked, how should I describe me as your prophet?
Yes.
It is right to say that God told Moses, I am has sent you.
Yes.
And this is the same I am that Yeshua said, I am twice in
yes.
John 18.
Yes. So in the Septuagint, the same language is used. In Hebrew, it's slightly different, obviously, because it's not Greek, it's Hebrew, but it's the equivalent, yes. And Yeshua says it at least 7 times within Yohanan's Gospel, and we could say that he implies it a number of other times.
I guess a lot of people say that Yeshua has never claimed deity. I just thought that this looks like one that I think people have missed.
Yeah, there are a lot of people who claim that Yeshua is not God with us. They are people who have to black out huge portions of Scripture. For example, I think this is an important thing tonight, actually. We had friends earlier tonight who believe exactly what you're saying, that Yeshua is not God with us. Well, the prophet Yeshayahu prophesied that the Messiah would be Immanuel, with us, God. This is not a convergent name. It's not a proper noun. It's 2 separate words that describes the Messiah's character, that he will be Immanu, separate Hebrew word, with us, El, God. So Isaiah literally prophesies the Messiah will be God. He also prophesies that the Messiah will be El, and then separate words, so God, Gibor, Almighty. He prophesies that he will be Avi, my father, Ad, who is eternal. So whoever the Messiah is going to be, from Isaiah's perspective, he is going to be God with us. Then Yeshua makes the statement, I am that I am. And he makes it 7 times in the Gospel of Yohanan. At the start of the Gospel of Yohanan, Yohanan says, in the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God. So he begins his whole Gospel by saying, Yeshua is divine. Deal with it. And then, one of the greatest indications, and people say Yeshua never said of himself that he was divine. Okay. Thomas, or Te'uma, the disciple, comes to Yeshua, having disbelieved that Yeshua had resurrected. Yeshua enters the room somehow in a transcendent way through locked doors, but appears physically in the room, and Thomas touches Yeshua's physical body, resurrected, in the wounds that he suffered on the cross. And in awe, Thomas says, Adoni Elohei, my Lord and my God. Adoni ve'Elohei, my Lord and my God. And does Yeshua say to him, don't blaspheme? No, Yeshua said, you believe because you've seen. He's saying, I am God with you, undeniably. To say that Yeshua never claimed to be God with us is an absolute lie. Cross that out of your scripture. And then the only go-to people have is to say, yes, well, that part of scripture isn't inspired. Or that part of scripture isn't inspired. Yalla, bye. Yeshua is God with us. Yeshua is God with us. Yeshua is God with us. Sister.
Is that why they sent so many people to get him?
Yeah, well, if you were going to go and arrest God with us, you want to make sure you had a lot of people. Of course, he just stated who he was and they all fell over, so. Yeah, Baruch Hashem. Okay, well, I think we'll wind it down. If there's more questions, we can chat as we pack up. It was a long night. We went right to our 9:30 cutoff here tonight, but I think it was a great passage of scripture, and I'm really excited and looking forward to us examining chapter 19 next week together. Another really powerful piece of text. So, Laila Tov, everybody. Shabbat Shalom, and we wish our online viewers Laila Tov and Shabbat Shalom. We look forward to having you join us next week. Thanks, brother.
The angle, see, that shot's really awesome.
You
can see the
but as you, the problem is there's no way to do that.
If we move it slightly so that it's the view from this camera as well, just a little adjustment.
Oh, you mean like this?
See, like that shot, you can see the Torah there.
Yeah.
But at this shot, you can't see it. It's sitting right behind you. So it might just off-center it. Because it just looks amazing.
Yeah, well, we could put the Torah in a different place too.
Yeah, just move it slightly. Yeah, see, it's hiding behind you?
Yeah.
Whereas if we just move it either side, then it'll still appear in that one as well.
Yeah, we can do that for sure.
Yeah, that was awesome.